Frozen is known as a Victor expert, playing that champion in solo queue before it really became a top pick here in Korea. There is the Varus ban, and that's just smart on the blue side because you don't want that to come in as a last pick for Frozen.
The bans are coming through very quickly. Kalista, Thresh, and Ryze join the ban pool, so you were actually very predictive. They're respecting the power of Ignaz Thresh and banning that away. Gragas jungle banned against Tucson.
Yeah, so Tucson does. He will probably default to Sejuani. LeBlanc actually going to be banned by IM. That is a bit of a puzzler for me, considering that they are on red side and they could have just taken it. Very safe pick. And Crown has played some LeBlanc, but it certainly hasn't been a world beater. Now, there is Sivir.
But think of the power that could be put over on red side. Alistar is available, not picked. We just mentioned that Ignaz Alistar is something to be feared. Sivir Alistar almost seems to be the gold standard of completed bot lanes that people are able to assemble, but there's a lot of strong champions. And in fact, I am priority on Rumble and Rek'Sai in the first round.
Yeah, the Rumble and Rek'Sai, they still don't have a good, solid primary engage yet. And Ignar, you know, he plays Thresh, he plays Alistar, and he plays Janna most of the time. So will he go for a Janna here? It doesn't have a lot of synergy, generally speaking, with that Rumble. You're going to be running a disengage composition, but we'll see how IM actually rounds out their comp. Instant Nidalee lock, that is. Very Eve, and there's the Alistar coming through as well.
It's already got CC in the bottom lane. You really want someone like Maokai in the top lane if you really want to have a lane for Nidalee to gank. She's a bit feast or famine when it comes to her role in the jungle. With her, all the attention in terms of nerfs on her base stats and her jungle clear, her ganks are still super powerful, but anything to make them more reliable, like targeted CC, really builds her up and makes her that snowball champion we know she can be.
Well, Samsung right now is setting up to have a pretty nice pick composition. They keep going this direction. They have so many options to create a pick with the speed, the mobility that they have. And are we going to see this Nautilus, or Ignar could go on the Annie for some more hard engage and lockdown? Annie Victor, not be a surprise. And there's the answer to their primary engage, and Frozen will get a big, big comfort pick for him.
Where will Samsung go with the West of their draft? They're not really pigeonholed into anything other than requiring some sort of engage tank. But they're not actually going to go for an engage tank. Sinking something out of Smeb's books and actually going for a top lane Riven.
Well, we saw how well Someday did in this Riven Rumble matchup just the other day. And granted, there was that Rumble dying to Wolves from Spenu right at level one, which did set him very far behind. But it's a tough matchup for Rumble to deal with because of Riven's all-in potential. And there's an incredible amount of burst damage if this Nidalee can really get into the top side and follow up on a Riven engage with a spear. That could potentially be a very easy kill onto Apple's Rumble.
It's gankable in the early game, and it also snowballs into what is just an unmanageable lane for Rumble. Whatever he gets, unless we're talking about 3,000 or 4,000 gold lead, he cannot deal with the Riven split push in the late game. In general, Rumbles have to build for team fights rather than necessarily having the freedom to stack armor for lane. So we'll struggle against Riven, but what a squishy lineup we're talking about from Samsung. There is the targeted CC, so there is the potential maybe even mid lane ganks coming through onto Twisted Fate from the Nidalee, but in the late game, if they ever go for a split push and Annie gets her flash Tibbers on, that is a squishy, squishy backline for LZIM's China Overrun.
That's true, but Samsung here, the team that has that incredible pick potential, they've got the mobility from Nidalee and the single target burst. You have a great 1-3-1 split push with Riven and Twisted Fate in this lineup. So with great poke from Samsung and Nidalee in the mid lane. So this composition going to be looking for picks. And I agree, if you get to that late game and you have to 5v5, you're probably doing something wrong as Samsung. Just go for those picks, start snowballing all these damage threats, and then focus on a split push come the mid and late game.
I can definitely agree with that. It feels like any team that really gets on top of either the objectives, whether it's gets the lead on the dragons or starts to take turrets, Twisted Fate comps in general, build Lich Bane, you can overextend and know Twisted Fate is going to react very fast with CC, so Samsung get ahead, I can like it. But in the backline, Vayne's pretty safe. It's going to be hard for Samsung to get on top of her, barring Twisted Fate getting a really good pick. So I actually like both comps, and it's not like IM don't have a comp that could really monopolize Dragon with the likes of Rumble Rek'Sai.
Yeah, absolutely. So interesting compositions coming in. Samsung has seen success with the Twisted Fate. Samsung does their best when they're on these pick comps. So can they execute once again? Luna won't be on the bar this time, but let's get into the game and see if Samsung can make it work or LZ will win the 5v5. All right, we're in game one, Samsung Galaxy versus Longju, Incredible Miracle. And everyone just starting to fan out right here. Ignar with that stun already built up with the W on the Annie. And Luna gonna face Checker Brush, but he's gonna donate some money, get his pockets picked a little bit. Wow, starting Q. Interesting.
And showing the Q as well. Got 8 gold from the first auto attack himself. Alistair is trying to equalize the gold out as much as possible. 541 to 523.
Look at this. A little bit of a bait right here. Crown picking that gold card.
8 second window till that expires. Oh. Ignar.
Oh, wow. Uh-oh. This could actually be very bad for Ignar. There's the exhaust going down right away. Stun, flash, pulverize, and goodbye, Ignar. First blood to Crown. Wow, that was some fun mind games right there. You definitely do not expect the mid laner to be in that brush at level one.
It is really interesting pathing from Samsung. Crown himself could have gone for a second Doran's or even safer mid lane, but goes for the boots. Boots 4 pots was a regular start for Twisted Fate. So now he has the flexibility to move away from the Rek'Sai pressure if he chooses to gank mid. It's a nice advantage for Samsung early.
Wow, I'm a little bit surprised that Ignar would make that decision to walk forward once he saw the Q. A little bit dangerous right there. Of course, Crown will get to lane a little bit late. He'll be just fine to start working on that back line with the red card.
What a weird and wonderful meta it is, Monte Cristo, where Riven top is becoming a thing that now 3 teams are playing in Champions.
Love it, Papa Smithy, because think about the top lane right now. Think about why this is so exciting. You know, for the first time, we have so many picks available in mid lane and top lane. You want to play a tank in top lane? Okay. You want to play Rumble up there? You want to play a caster? You want to play Vlad? Fine, fine, fine. And then now we've got some big burst champions, Echo, Riven, highly mechanical champions coming into the top lane as well. It's just a very exciting time for team compositions and strategy.
So what this has meant in bottom lane is that Ignar has flashed down what is already a tricky lane for Vayne. Annie is now super difficult. They have to respect Samsung incredibly in this situation. So it feels like Civ is going to have free reign of bottom lane. Aurora just has to deal with the fact that his support made almost an unforced error in the first couple of seconds.
Yeah, that's a big advantage. But again, we came into this game, we said some of these advantages, you know, they may not matter because both of these teams have been so poor at closing out their leads. I mean, famously, Incredible Miracle lost a game where they had all 3 inhibitors and all 11 turrets down for KT. Naked Nexus, double super minion waves coming in, and they lost. So, you know, there are questions.
Early advantages only mean so much if you can end the game. I completely agree. Tucson's coming on to Crown. Still has flash available, but actually gets affected by the CC. Should be able to get out.
Yeah, does get out, has that cleanse, interestingly enough, in the mid lane this game, just to deal with the Annie. That's the only reason why he'd be taking that summoner spell. I don't know about that. I think the ghost may be a little bit better here. I feel like if you're Twisted Fate and you're getting caught out by Annie, you've probably already done something wrong.
Twisted Fate builds usually needed to itemize mobility. For example, we used to see Twin Shadows coming in from builds just to give you the chance of getting that second gold card. Then Ghost evolved as a summoner spell choice so you could get it. Now suddenly, the second gold card, he doesn't quite have the mobility to necessarily pick that up unless he goes for specific itemization around it. So pick potential from Twisted Fate, the initial pick, it's always going to come, but the secondary pick might be tough.
That's right. Tucson right there just looking for an angle coming in through the Dragon Pit, but Fury and Luna playing pretty passively now in this lane and not going to be attempting too much IM down on that bottom side. Meanwhile, Kuvei and Apple just continue farming up right here. Apple not having issues in terms of CSing, in terms of farming just yet. No early moves from the junglers either, so Eve just going to go back. Interesting build. Eve generally likes to get a very early tier, not this game.
You know, obviously, the extra AP will help with the power of his ganks, but just makes them less reliable. There's less likely a chance that you're going to be able to clear the jungle as fast without the big mana stacking coming through. I expected a lot of people to be, especially the junglers, to be around the top lane just because both of these champions overextend when they're trying to harass. Using either of the Q abilities to harass the enemy will push your wave, so I expect the junglers to visit, but maybe we're going to have to wait till Twisted Fate hits 6 to see action around the top lane.
Well, there are some wards in the top side as Kuvei is pushing for it. Eve is down here, though he is seen in the river. And he's going to come through and start to clear out some of these tunnels. Ignar holding back, waiting to see if Eve is interested in getting some poke down, but he is not, just back on racing through the jungle right now. And Crown and Frozen, it's been a very farm-centric game, which I'm sure I am as happy with, but that level 6 from Crown's Twisted Fate is going to be coming up very soon, and at that point we may see some shenanigans begin.
And it feels like IM's biggest weakness as a team. We see Luna actually get the engage, a lot of burst damage onto Roar, but the back end of the Boomerang Blade doesn't hit, so Roar can stay in lane, albeit very low health.
Yeah, very low health, no more pots either. Fury still has his health pot, so even though this lane is, it was kept up early by Roar, this is going to be the point where he has to go back, where they are definitely going to lose some CS onto Vayne, as you would expect, but here's Apple. Equalizer dropped, and that's the Wind Slash getting the execute onto Apple. Ooh.
As we jumped into top, you could actually see the Prowl, the passive proc, was already on top of the Rumble, so you can, of course, take from that that the spear had been hit. The assassination comes through. We were waiting for that attention up top. It didn't even require Twisted Fate.
No, didn't yet. And that is very scary because the snowballing now that can come in on this Riven is absolutely crazy. The number of dives, I mean, if we think about how mobile that combination of TF, Nidalee, and Riven is, it's going to be a lot more lockdown. And Tucson has to respond to this. The question is, how is Tucson going to respond? Is he going to try and just stay bottom side, try and take away the camps from the bottom side if Eve continues to camp top and take the dragon, or is he going to try and combat this one-on-one? Wow, that was a great spear right in front of the minion wave. Threaded the needle really nicely on that one.
Yeah, max range, threading it through. Very nice mechanics coming through from Eve. You mentioned this is a priority pick for him and the team. Justifying, and look, they're back again in Twisted Fate with the potential to join them if things get hairy.
Yeah, and Victor is already getting the blue buff right now, so there's basically a free port from Crown if he wants it. Apple knows this, so he's just going to back off right away. Pink ward in the river, so they know they've got Apple a little bit blind right now, and he's just going to not even deal with this. Watch him walk down to the Raptors instead of sticking around in lane.
It's actually something I've seen consistently from Apple, is that he understands when he's under threat, and he's happy to get denied multiple waves if that's necessary. It's notable that although he died, he still has Flash available. So, look, he's never safe against Twisted Fate, Nidalee, Riven when he's in lane, but at least he has the Summoner for some semblance of hope when it comes to the inevitable three-man game.
Yeah, he's also just going to go farm jungle camps right now. I think this is a very good decision for him, trying to play as safely as possible. And it may not matter too much if he dies, as long as he continues to get levels and not fall too far behind. But it is very important that he doesn't feed the Riven. He may not need those items, he may not need that CS, but certainly Kuvei can profit massively off of having a gold lead. So some caution, I think, is well warranted, preventing the snowball from getting out of control in this game.
Apple, just in general, is got a lot of things working against him. The reality of a Twisted Fate pick, one of the reasons why this champion's always in the meta, is that he always reacts first when it comes to skirmishes and other lanes with that global teleport. So when you already have a 1v1 laning advantage, which is what Riven innately has against basically every champion, but certainly against a champion that wants to be building for team fights, building for the equalizer, compared to necessarily laning stats in Apple's Rumble, Riven will get items, she'll pick up the Tiamat, she'll have lots of wave clear advantages because, of course, Rumble's Q does reduce damage against those lane minions. And then Twisted Fate can react, so the split push should be so powered up in the late game. We'll see the engage coming on. Tucson gets Fury very low.
Yeah, and there's the spell shield already popped. He's going to try and get out with his ultimate. Tucson not going to be able to finish it up. Luna pops the ult himself to get out safely. There's a flash Tibbers in there just to make sure that they could get something. No teleports used, however. Crown also not holding holding onto his ultimate right there and just pushing forward onto the turret. Frozen made some motions down to that bottom side, but he comes back up to clear out the wave. Eve trying to get a little bit of auto attack damage. Eve is very... Oh, wow. Fury coming forward again. There's a headbutt out. Ignar not going to get any kind of stun right here, except for a follow-up one onto Luna, but that's not going to be enough to kill him.
Luna's super tanky. Doesn't have the ultimate, so has to back away. Crucially, IM committed 3 summoner spells. They want to get something. They couldn't get a pick. They're on top of this dragon. The ward times out, but it doesn't look like Samsung in any place to contest.
IM did a good job. Chunk out that bot lane, then immediately go for this dragon. Apple is starting to get very nervous now, and he should be. There is the port coming in. Gold card into a spear and a kill. Apple, oh, gets the flash, but Crown still finishes him off.
There's just nothing he can do whatsoever. Yeah. He can't hang 1v1 with the Riven, then finds multiple members in his lane. Apple will be lucky to be a relevant threat, even in terms of equalizer damage, because both CS and experience are being expertly zoned away from his possibility by Samsung.
Yeah, after that relatively even early game, since the pressure has come into the top side, Apple has dropped behind a level. Now, I like what IM did, though. Just some good back and forth right here. Get the dragon, and then Samsung responds appropriately, punishing them for it with the death of Apple. So the question is, can IM snowball off this dragon? Because Apple, even though he's been denied, still going to be useful with that equalizer in the mid-game teamfight. So if they can continue to get dragons, it will be worth having him die a few times early in this game.
Yeah, fighting around dragons is definitely their hope, but as we mentioned, split pushing is what Samsung's going to be focusing on. So I think both teams in the early game have gotten, say, the first objective towards their victory condition that they wanted. But Samsung in general, it feels like they have the more reliable options because they have split push and they have that global threat from Twisted Fate. IM, they're all in on dragons, and that's always a risk.
And I love seeing how TF's build, because there is a very big difference between what your power is early in the game when you only have one or two items on Twisted Fate, and it tells you a lot about how a TF player should be playing. In this case, you want to go Lichbane first, you need to split push. This is a split pushing build on TF, which means that they need to get control over the bottom side so that they can get the Riven into the mid lane and start to really put even more pressure on with the Twisted Fate, because that the cooldown boots and the Sheen or the Lichbane are just going to chew through these turrets.
It's one of those situations also where they want to break the outer ring of turrets and just start overextending with all their globals and the general mobility. Riven and Nidalee, super maneuverable champions. Sivir has the ultimate as well to move between lanes. If they can break some outer turrets, they can create a situation where, okay, fighting Dragon 5v5 is hard, but if they can push the waves and get exclusive wards around that particular area, if they have their most powerful champion split pushing in the bottom lane, suddenly it becomes that much more difficult for IM to fight.
Okay, and there's an engage right there. Ignar just gets destroyed. Chain CC'd by a great flash. Frozen down there. Kuve's in with his ultimate. Hopping around, but Tucson escapes through the tunnel. They're still going to get a blue buff, however. Wow, that was a very sudden fight, but Samsung playing great with this Twisted Fate this game.
And it's no coincidence they're fighting around the bottom side. There's no dragon to fight about, but if they break this bottom turret, move Riven to split push in that area, suddenly dragon is that much more difficult for IM to pick up. So first, for the first 10 minutes, focusing all their attention around top lane, it's no coincidence that now the attention is all around the dragon area.
Right, and they had the teleport advantage as well, and with the TP advantage and the TF, that was basically just destined to be a 5v3 scenario. So a very easy dive, but Samsung doing all the right things. And, you know, this is much more of the Samsung that we saw earlier in the season. They're playing out their win conditions really well this game. They're executing nicely around the cooldowns of their enemy. They had a tricky level one. I like this composition a lot. And this Samsung didn't show up in the past 2 weeks, which is unfortunate. They didn't really come to play against Najin or Anarchy. And maybe they're a little bit back on track now when we saw them play against teams like the Ku Tigers and SKT.
It's notable that when Samsung's on form, they're debuting something new from Kuve, usually actually, in fact. Of course, we saw the top lane Rek'Sai really grain priority. Kuve playing that champion very well despite not picking a win up with it. now going towards a pure carry top. I think it's no coincidence the last couple of series where Samsung really haven't been competitive, they've tried to play the meta and they just unfortunately haven't done it as well as their opposition.
Well, Papa, with all the Riven picks these days, I'm not convinced that Riven is not, in fact, the meta.
The Riven meta. It's always been the case in solo queue. That's nothing new. But in competitive play, teams are getting, they're playing around it smart. They're not just picking Riven and dealing with her. It's either champions like Gragas where they create those multiple skirmish options, or it's just in these situations where you can overextend so safely when you have the global help of Twisted Fate.
Well, remember though, too, that a lot of the Ku Tigers Riven compositions rely on poke. The idea is teleport Riven is fantastic for just getting into the middle of a team after they've already been poked out and just one-shotting them for the rest of their life. And that's how Ku have been playing it with kiting compositions. That's how we saw Smeb get that pentakill earlier this season on Riven. And it's sort of the same idea here. You have a Boomerang Blade, you've got the wild cards, you have the Nidalee Spears, you can poke them out, and if Kuvei comes in on your flank after that, you are just dead to rights.
And the other factor, of course, that Riven brings is execution damage. When we're talking about Nidalee hitting the spear, you focus both the Wind Slash and the Pounce onto that single target. We're talking about massive single target damage, and a 5v4, a 5v5, difficult for this team, but 5v4, very possible.
Indeed. Well, there's Frozen, tagged by that pick a card and the Lich Bane right now. That already completed, and Samsung going to start making a press for this mid lane. Again, they've already taken out that bot lane turret. Eve is there to provide more poke, and there's just not enough wave clear here to really deal with this for Incredible Miracle, and they're just going to deny as many creeps as possible. And are they actually going to take this turret? Looks like they want to give the gold to Fury. So he'll pick it up, and that is another outer turret, and guess what? That makes three for Samsung.
They get that outer ring we talked about. Suddenly the dragon, which looked so difficult for them to opt into, of course the first dragon going over to IM, it's going to be completely uncontested, even though teleport is available from Apple. So with a teleport advantage, there's still just no way for them to contest these objectives when all their waves are being pushed up, and they just never have been in the position to put down wards in the last 2-3 minutes.
Yeah, indeed. Well, Apple is going to push that wave in. Kuvei's still going to pick up the minions, though. Apple's kind of gotten back into this game. He's only 25 CS down, which when you consider what has happened to him already, is not actually that much. But his itemization, he's had to invest so much money into boots.
And this is something that Marin does on his Rumble as well. He's happy to get into the early home guards, but that's for fighting around objectives, and they've just watched an objective fall down for free.
Yeah, that is much more problematic indeed. And, you know, it's also just so much harder to snowball off the dragon now for IM as they let one slip through the cracks. And now with Kuvei completing that Tiamat, the split pushing is going to be in full swing as long as he can continue to lane against the Rumble. If he has to lane against the Vayne, it's going to be a different story with that Hex Drinker. Starting to get a little bit nervous here, one would think. Crown still in base, but they could engage this, potentially.
Just a fate, not quite in range yet, but you can see Alistar and Nidalee, Sivir, in fact, all walking towards top, relieving pressure for Kuvei. Not going to be able to take that turret. It's interesting, both mid laners, in fact, have that line wave clear that allows them to kill the minion wave as it approaches in a straight line. So straight line wave clear from both Victor and Twisted Fate means that these waves are being cleared basically instantly before they even break.
But the difference, I think, the critical difference is that when you have that straight line wave clear and you're running a poke composition or you're playing against a poke composition, you often are not going to be able to stand there and clear the wave as it comes into turret. You have to let the wave hit the turret where it's not in a line anymore. Otherwise, you're standing too far forward and you're going to get hit by wild cards or a Nidalee Spear. So in a way, I think Frozen having that line wave clear, when we're talking about how much poke he has to dodge, isn't a particularly good thing. He's just going to miss minions that way, really.
And it's important that Samsung actually took away the blue. That's why we saw them actually be able to take out the mid turret, is that the only person with any semblance of wave clear, straight line or not, is Frozen. Didn't have the blue. He's down to about 100 mana.
See, here we go.
Destiny activated. No way to juke this for all.
Yeah, already there. Stun into stun. Nice chaining. Samsung's execution has been really good on this Twisted Fate. And this is how they beat the Ku Tigers, too. They played the TF with the Bard, with the Sivir, and they created picks. They got They got onto Prey. They're very decisive today. Much more decisive than we normally have seen in the past couple of matches with their shot calling.
And Twisted Fate Bard is different to Twisted Fate Alistar in one way, of course. Don't have that same global Tempered Fate, but you can still turret dive so well with the Alistar, similar to if you use the Tempered Fate to disable a turret. So it was their turret game that let them down, ironically, in their last series against Anarchy. If they can be assertive, there's a lot more standing goal for them to pick up on the map, despite having that 3-0 turret advantage.
Yeah, Fury now starting to invade the enemy jungle. Another buff taken away by Samsung. Crown is sitting there eating a flame spitter. They want to get another kill. There's the gold card into the wild cards. Kuve just going to pop on in and force the flash from Apple. No more follow-up, however. And that's enough. Can they get this tower now? Huge split push.
Vayne looking for safe places to farm and not finding any. They're rotating around the empty lanes that Vayne is trying to appear in and just taking turrets under her nose. Nothing she can do. They even take this outer turret in the bottom. This is a full court press from Samsung.
I really like how after we were very critical of Samsung in the last game that they were not aggressive enough when they needed to be. What they're doing now is they're just crushing IM and taking a massive gold lead in this game by playing really aggressively, by actually executing on these dives too. They look much more confident, and they have the skills to back it up too. They've done very well mechanically in these ganks.
They just understand what they have, and that's the ability to have such a severe advantage in pushing and just in reacting to skirmishes. They're always going to be in a five-man response, whereas it's only situationally that Frozen, for example, can be in position to impact. So much immediate power now, 40% CDR, and the Lich Bane completed for Twisted Fate. Global presence, it's on a short cooldown.
Yeah, that is pretty huge right now. Kuve also that huge threat. Last Whisper added to his inventory. So I guess he's got a bow to go with his sword now.
No Brutalizer, actually just future-proofing himself. He would have had probably more immediate damage with the Brutalizer pickup. There's not a lot of armor picked up by LZM just yet, but it's still a good use of 2,300 gold.
Yeah, definitely. So I am trying to group up. They need to force this 5v5 fight and hope that they're not too far behind in gold. But with 10k down, they almost certainly are at too much of an item disadvantage to actually win the 5v5. And they don't have any solutions to deal with Kuve's Riven.
Raw desperately needs a QSS, but doesn't have the damage necessary to do it. We're waiting to see if Annie engages. If that's going to be a Samsung engage.
And Ignar going to drop immediately. Fury going to spell shield the Tivers, look like, on the backside. Crown still there. Kuve just going nuts on a turret. And now it's time to stop some recalls for Samsung. Can they get an inhibitor right now? Fury trying to follow up. They're a little bit wary about walking into that jungle, but instead they're just going to rush the mid lane, clear out the wave, and head right to the Baron.
It's so critical that they were able to do this without even using the Destiny. They didn't even have to threaten the global to get this objective. Won't be able to take down the inhibitor as a one-man job, but as you mentioned, four men bashing down at this Baron, and LZIM had to react to the inhibitor damage.
Wow. This is looking like an incredible, it's just such a different Samsung team compared to the one we saw against Anarchy. Aggressive and decisive, but this has been Samsung when they play their style. They play great split push and pick comps. This is what they do well. And I like to see that we're returning to it, because when they try these more 5v5 teamfight oriented comps, it just doesn't work as well for them. Let's take a look at this replay right now. Luna with the knockup, and here's the follow-up as well.
This is in a 4v5 situation. They get the pick, and then at this point, they're just trying to buy time for the split push. You can see the blue pings on the minimap. Kuve having his way with the turret. They don't even have to use Destiny to stop the recalls. They have so much mobility. Sivir, Nidalee, Alistar, all very quick, and Kuve gets the free objective.
I think they could have gotten the inhibitor if they had used the Destiny right there, but that's neither here nor there. Tucson going to be found in a brush, and that is not where you want to find yourself against a Riven. Is going to get the tunnel out, but his recall is delayed. And you know, one thing about that last fight, we talked about Ignar being this great Thresh player, this great Alistar player, but Ignar straight up saw Fury spell shield, and like a full second after the spell shield, he dropped Tibbers on him, and it did nothing. So that was a really weird ultimate from Annie, because it wasn't like Fury instinctively or reflexively spell shielded. It was just sitting there on him while he was autoing Annie, so not really sure about that from Ignar. Pretty poor ultimate.
When it comes to Annie, she's only really starting to come back to things in Champions. Of course, Wolf played it to great success last week, but in general, it's been more of an LPL pick than necessarily a Champions pick. Yesterday, Luna, now today, Ignar. To me, it's a champion that seems pretty straightforward. Flash Tibbers, but if you miss that Tibbers, you literally contribute nothing.
Yeah, we've seen some pretty bad Annie play in the last couple of days. That's for sure. But we did see some extraordinary Annie play from Wolf last week. That was very good. Very good Annie. So now Samsung back to the split push. Again, being very decisive and aggressive in how they close this out, forcing those hard decisions from IM about which champions to allocate where. Tucson wants a flank right now, but that's not going to be an easy commodity. And there's another miss Tibbers, and Ignar just going to get Sivir ulted on and run over as Kuve shows up in the back line and executes Ignar.
Just completely executed. 8 seconds of reveal onto Vayne means she can't do anything. She cannot be the slippery threat that she's known as. It doesn't matter that the 5v5 comp that's been assembled by M is stronger on paper. It doesn't matter when you're 16k gold behind.
Not much matters in League of Legends when you're 16k gold.
It's only at 26 minutes, too. We're not talking about a 50-minute advantage similar to the one that IM just couldn't put KT away with. This is a massive, massive advantage for Samsung.
Wow. This is definitely not what I expected coming into this match, Papa Smithy. And Samsung just going to move forward onto this tower right now. They want to take as much of this base as they can. No more Baron buff. They're making it work. Luna is knocked around, condemned into the wall. And Kuve still wants to go 1v1 versus Tucson. He's just a distraction, though, for another dead inhibitor. And Samsung in this game, nearly a perfect game. If IM hadn't gone for that dragon, this would be a perfect game situation from Samsung. Very strong performance.
The words used to describe Samsung this game were decisive and aggressive. And to be honest, if you'd watched their last couple of series, you could only anoint them those words in an ironic sense. They hadn't shown anything of that sort of form that's got them to take games off top opposition. But throwing out their previous playbook, what a nightmare to have to scout this team. If you're scouting them based on the last two games, you would have thought this was going to be a straightforward game where they just kind of make poor decisions around objectives. They played so aggressively that even if they have those weaknesses in the late game, how much is that really going to count for?
Right, and Crown just, yes, he played some TF earlier this season, but they looked like they were putting such a high priority on Victor so far, and it's just been a very, very different approach from Samsung. I think after those last couple of losses where they struggled so much, I think they looked back and said, okay, well, what did we do when we're in this two-game losing streak or two-match losing streak where we haven't won a game, we're 0-4? What did we do earlier to take some games off of the top teams in this league? And this looks much more similar to what we saw from them early in the season.
I feel like the matchup, Twist of Fate against Victor, is one that we're going to see more and more. For example, when Xerath was really coming to prominence, people realized, okay, you can actually play Twisted Fate, match the wave clear, and have to go impact. We're going to see the turret dive coming through.
Yeah, Ignar just going to fall immediately right there. Gravity field not going to be enough to save him. And look at Kuve, he's still on the flank. He's looking for that engage. There it is. He's just going to blow everyone up. Waited very patiently to get in. Double kill for Frozen. But that is not going to be enough to save this game, as the super minions tanking the turrets should mean a dead Nexus. Frozen is just cut off from this fountain right now. And is he going to get through? No. Flash. Fury actually dies. Impressive play from Frozen on the defense right here, but there's a Lich Bane and a Riven on your Nexus. He's going to get another double kill. Is he actually going to get a delayed Penta? No, not quite. Oh! Well, that's the end of the game, though.
A decisive and aggressive 28-minute win for Samsung was the last thing we expected when we came to the studio today, Monte Cristo. It's a sign of a top team, or at least a team on the up, that can throw away recent embarrassing losses and come back so strong in a game where, realistically, we didn't expect much from Samsung.
And I certainly didn't expect to open this match up. We talked about how both of these teams had been struggling to close. Well, look at this. Not even a very high kill game, honestly, all things considered. Samsung only had 10 kills, but they still won in 28 minutes. They snowballed so well off of those early ganks, getting turrets, getting barons, great play.
Pretty Christo. An interesting statistic. Riven is 5-0 for the season. I did not expect that in this Cinderhulk meta, but as Cinderhulk starts to get nerfed, as we see, as you mentioned, casters in the top lane, tanks in the top lane, now even just straight damaged carries like Riven. 5-0 Riven on the season.
And for those of you keeping track at home, that's 1-0 for Samsung, 1-0 for KT with Sunday playing it. And then we had 3-0 for SMEB, the KU Tigers once again, bringing in some new picks to the scene. They are very innovative this year, the KU Tigers. They found a lot of stuff that works for them. Sivir, the usual ban against Fury, is going to reappear in this game. And there is the Ryze ban from Apple. I guess he not wanting to play that this game. Although Kuvei was playing Sivir, or playing Ryze before 5.10. So he was actually drawing Ryze bans at 5.9. It's just a specialty champion of his. And now that it is as powerful as it is right now, you really don't want to give that one over.
So if you're Sam, if you're LZIM right now, you're feeling shell-shocked, Monte Cristo. You did not expect to lose the first game, certainly in the 28-minute fashion that you did. Do you need to add, we know the answer, they haven't, but are there any adaptation bans that you think should have come through? I don't think the Riven needs a ban. It feels like teams have just been smart about picking that into the right situation. Is it just opting into champions like Victor with champions like Twisted Fate available, or does TF actually need a ban?
I don't think TF needs a ban here because it's just, Samsung's good with it, but there are options. Now, of course, with Samsung on the red side, picking that TF is going to be easier. But that said, it's not like Apple played particularly poorly against the TF either. He backed off when he needed to. There are going to be some inevitable kills, but IM did trade that first dragon for a death onto Apple, which is totally worth it. So I think it's just much more about caution from the other lanes, and maybe they think they can deal with it. Now, the other problem here is, what happens if Samsung takes that Rek'Sai right now, that champion that they have been so good at flexing, and it's such a powerful pick for them on red side. If they pick this Corki early again, they'll pop up. I'm just going to really be confused.
Yeah, the Corki, I agree with, and they lock it in, but the Maokai still opens up the Nidalee. I did mention during the pregame for Game 1 that great synergy between Nidalee and Maokai when it comes to ganking for your top lane. I am actually thinking about taking away the Twisted Fate, or they're just hovering in this particular situation. One of the reasons why I talk about the TF, Frozen was 4-0-1 on the Victor, by far the best score, a decent scoreline in any game. It's just he was almost a non-factor, much like when GBM was playing Xerath and had a decent score in a losing game.
Also, Papa, he was 0-0-0 up until the final Nexus push when he got two double kills and Apple picked up a kill on Rumble where he had the assist, and then the Super Minions killed the Nexus. So the final ace was the only thing he did that entire game.
He cleared some waves.
That is true.
He got some fantasy points.
Well, I mean, still, though, just not very impactful. I mean, Samsung's snowball was so brutal that there really wasn't much he could do.
He just can't make, I mean, Victor's not a champion that can keep TF accountable. You need jungle help to be able to get any sort of assassination potential on the TF. So it just ended up being wave clear wars with, of course, the global ultimate meaning that TF was that much more relevant. Now on the red side, that's the reason why I brought up the TF ban, is that on the red side, they're going to probably lock in this Nidalee, have that Nidalee Maokai we talked about. They're going to leave the pick open, and I guess you have to blind pick a champion that can deal with Twisted Fate, because the threat is still there with this comp.
Yeah, it is definitely there. And it's hard, because Twisted Fate is one of those red side or counter picks that is so powerful, because of course his ult is amazing, and yes, he does have counters, but you can't really just pick a Fizz right now and expect to do well. So his counter picks are not really first pickable in their own right, so he is tough to deal with, especially if you're going to be drafting on blue side against the TF playing team.
And they've banned LeBlanc, which of course will be one of the safer champions that can both deal with him in lane and be very relevant in this meta. They were forced to ban LeBlanc on blue. Now that's not an option to pick. Will Frozen just default to a champion like Cassiopeia, who can get on top of Twisted Fate in lane, but certainly isn't necessarily a hard counter to him as a champion?
I would be really worried about picking Vladimir here. Yes, Apple can play it in the top side, but mid Vladimir just doesn't have the wave clear early in the game to deal with TF's first couple of ports.
Could still be a top lane Vladimir, yep, though. They haven't locked in the top lane. Is this the matchup that we did see him run Vladimir in? I believe it might have been Vladimir Maokai. It's the sort of lane you can run over. He's going to confidently lock in Victor once again and invite the TF?
Not sure about this. It really didn't work out last game. Samsung demonstrated that they are very good at using the Nidalee and the TF together to quickly focus down kills and get those picks. Vladimir is going to be the decision, but that's another top laner that has a lot of danger when it comes to overextending and many ways to kill with a Maokai and a Nidalee and a possible, and I would say likely, TF coming in.
I guess the only thing you could say is that if they invite this Twisted Fate, they must understand that the only way they can win is to get Vladimir stronger than Maokai. If Maokai can outpush in much the same way that Riven was able to outpush the Rumble, it feels like IAM are just going to fall into the familiar trap that they did last game. So I expect both teams to put a lot of pressure around top. This is a matchup we've seen happen already. It was actually against Samsung that Crown felt the wrath of Goong's Zed, and of course also most recently Mickey Zed. It's not quite Twisted Fate, but split push pressure still going to be put out by the Zed.
Now, Crown on Zed is not something that we've seen. He has shown a very wide champion pool, and Zed will be the lock-in, so we'll see something new from Crown tonight, something exciting. His LeBlanc has been good. I mean, it's not like he hasn't played Assassins well in the past, and he definitely wants to turn the tables, having been the Zedded victor. He will now be the Zed to his enemies, Victor.
Victor has to take the exhaust summoner spell. Again, I expect a lot of action around top. Apple has shown that Vladimir can get to this situation where Maokai's high base damage don't threaten him and just outpush the Maokai. In that situation, I think Samsung's game plan might fall apart a little bit, but Nidalee and Maokai, excellent ganking pressure onto top lane.
And not to mention, Samsung sets themselves up with an extremely strong 4-1. Corki, Nidalee for poke and siege. They've got good disengage. And then, of course, that Zed. Not that IM doesn't have any answers, that Vladimir is going to be useful in terms of split pushing, but definitely more powerful for Samsung. Again, IM looks like they want that big fight in the 5v5, but this time, at least they have the Lucian into the Corki. They're going to have more winning lanes, a little bit more wave clear than they brought, so maybe some better ways to deal with Samsung splitting.
But can Vladimir outpush a Maokai early and then be the split push threat against the Zed? That's the question. Can you itemize the Zonias and also all the other items to be equally relevant? Because it's all about Vladimir and IM to stop Samsung's game plan from happening.
That's right. Well, we'll see what Samsung can do against IM in game number two. Apparently, Tucson hates items this game. That's what I learned.
We saw him play Fizz. He seemed to hate items there with his Devour Trinity Force Jungle Fizz. But
I thought he just hated me by doing that build.
Doesn't even have a trinket.
Wow. I mean, this is quite unusual.
He had places to be, Monte Cristo.
He had to get in that brush and stand on a bunch of Nidalee traps.
And now they have perfect information that he's not in any place to skirmish. If I saw that, it would be invade time.
Yeah, that is very true. I mean, not like the machete's really going to give you a lot of combat statistics in the early game anyway, so I'm not sure how much it matters right there. But Tucson, it does go back, does pick up his trinket finally, and will get his machete. So a little bit of a slip-up, but it's not going to cause any long-lasting damage unless they wanted to actually do something early. It's like we have a family member of Luna's in the audience today.
Saw their son or their family member do very, very well in the last game, so that extra confidence could only have been helpful. Ignar's on the Alistar this game. It's something we didn't mention. The Alistar's traded hands. We've already mentioned that Ignar, a notable Alistar player, gonna have to show something good here if IM can wrestle a game back in this series, because 2-0 Samsung, certainly not the result we expected.
And they've set themselves up with another good split pushing and pick composition, something they executed absolutely beautifully in the first game of the series. Tucson and Apple just going for a little bit of double jungling right now, and of course, Roar is going to be on that lane bully this time. Not going to have to worry about losing lane as Vayne against Sivir.
Both both top lanes. Just finding a bit of extra experience, not actually vertical jungle in this game. Standard lanes, but quick level 2 is going to be enacted by both top lanes.
Yep, and it's pretty much what we see from every single top these days, whether it's a caster like Vlad or Rumble, or a tank that can solo some of these camps like Kuve can on this Maokai.
The last time we saw Apple play Vladimir, he soloed, I believe, the Wolf camp as Vladimir with Doran Shield. Now, this time it was a jungle follow, but we've already been surprised once by the Vladimir.
Yeah, and just starting with the Tides of Blood, too, that game. Pretty interesting. I didn't know you could do that, but Apple had a good idea, managed to pull it off. So just back into the standard lanes, though. And like you were saying, that's the really interesting conundrum for Apple in this game is he has to be the one to stop Crown Splitbush on Zed. But he's also in a lane against the Maokai, and he's going to need magic resist. So his timing to stop the split, if he's lucky, maybe he can get a kill and start snowballing, getting the necessary core items that he's going to need to both lane in against Maokai and be a threat against Zed in the split push. But otherwise, it's going to be a long time, and Zed's going to hit a power spike and be a major threat, and it'll be whether IM can actually weather that storm. Looks like a little skirmish right there from Eve, but Tucson hops over the wall on his trinket ward.
Yeah, the absolute cheapest possible build that Apple could put out would be, say, Revolver into Spectre's Cowl into Zhonya's. But we're still talking about a significant gold investment, 1,200 gold, 1,400 gold, and then the 3.3K. We're still talking about around 6,000 gold to be relevant in the split push. Compare that to Blade the Ruined King and a Brutalizer, especially in mid lane. It should be much easier for Crown to get there. So the timings, as you mentioned, will be the key factor. If Apple can get to that oppressive Vladimir state, he will actually deal with a lot of the different ideas that Samsung have about trying to get a big mid-game advantage. But if he can't, it feels like IM's comp might, very similar to last game, fall apart a little bit.
Yeah, I do have that concern as well. Keeping eyes on this mid lane, because Crown at 6, basically if Nidalee hits a spear, there's going to be a Zed and a Nidalee who can just get on top of this Victor, and there's literally nothing that Frozen can do about it. The Pounce will come in, the Death Mark will come in, and he is going to have a very difficult time living through that scenario.
Never want to underrate Lee Sin in 2v2 duels, though. There is a lot of damage potential from both these laners. I have to agree, I expect Victor to try and hold the wave towards his turret, because turret diving at Victor is suddenly much more difficult when he has exhaust and, of course, the instant burst damage coming through from the ultimate. And Lee Sin, no, Lee Sin's the first person to visit top. I expected the Maokai nearly to be the call, but do they have enough damage? You don't think so when we're ganking for a Vladimir, but they actually do draw the flash.
I'm actually quite surprised that Kuve flashed right there, because he had already gotten the Twisted Advance down, and just didn't seem that necessary, because Apple's Q is still going to be on a relatively long cooldown this early in the game.
And what a successful gank. Usually you're talking about a kill in this situation, but to blow the flash and actually clear out the defensive ward with the Raptor buff, suddenly Maokai's going to have to play so much safer, and it should mean free farm for Apple in a lane where he's already at least 8 CS ahead.
It's nice right there. Eve looks like he may want to do something. There's a ward right there in the lane from the Lee Sin earlier. And Sapling in the Tri-Brush is going to see the Trinket Ward go down from Apple. So Eve just not going to be able to make a play there anytime soon.
Sticking with the same build, not prioritizing the early tier. Maybe Magus into tier will be the build choice coming from Eve, but valuing the higher AP values for theoretically more impactful ganks in the early game.
Yeah, I think that was really one of the key factors last game to Eve's performance, was just that he had those more powerful ganks. Eve really liked to stack up that tier. He was famous for getting a fully stacked tier by about 18 minutes on that jungle Nidalee, so extremely quick. Tucson wants to make a return here. Eve is nowhere near. Kuve already has his ult, though. He's going to walk into it. Evo Plate goes down. Kuve going to bounce Tucson off with that Arcane Smash, but he's going to die in the end. Popped for a first blood from Apple.
Very nice play from Tucson. Opens it up, first clearing the ward and getting the flash out, then just sneaking into lane and picking up the kill. Just very smart sense from IM. It opens up pressure on the bottom side. Lucian hadn't shopped crucially. Fury actually took the time to shop. The wave got pushed in, but this opens up the smart window to take Dragon. And there's nothing LZIM can do barring some sort of Ignar heroics.
Well, Ignar heroics would be
the Flash headbutt to steal the dragon?
That would be amazing, Bobby Smithy. And it would also end up with a dead Ignar, 100%. So, not sure that would really be the kind of victory they want this early in the game. Crown going for a Hex Drinker first with this build, so respecting some of the damage that Frozen can deliver. Tucson, a much more successful early game, is going to go to Warrior Enchant. Taking away the blue buff, not really going to hurt the Zed that much, but it's still a nice takeaway.
So far this game, IM have followed Samsung's playbook from game one almost identically, ganking top lane, parlaying that into blue buff contests, and just giving up the first dragon. It's exactly what got Samsung their big lead in game one. As you mentioned, taking away the blue buff from Zed, not the biggest factor. In fact, the Nidalee might have even been the one to pick up that second blue just to take advantage of the fact that she'd been going for the AP rather than necessarily the Tier. But all in all, not a big factor, but otherwise, mirror starts between games.
Yeah, the big, big difference that we have to comment on, though, is that last game, when IM did do this start, they had a big gold lead, more than 400, because they were getting massive CS advantages, particularly in that Riven Rumble lane as well. So they were able to snowball it into more than just kills, right? They just kept Apple down and kept Kuvei up the entire time. So it's up to IM to see if they can get this Vladimir. Apple's play on this Vladimir is so important to deal with the Zed in the mid game that it's going to be, they need to do more in this circumstance than they have already. Kuvei only down 7-8 CS, not going to be that impactful.
So Tucson's going for the Warrior Enchant, very necessary in this case. Of course, Vladimir ganking for his lane. Doesn't offer very much in terms of damage, especially early, but with the Hemo Plague and, of course, the high base damage from Lee Sin, when you get the Warrior, they do have kill pressure on a Maokai who just has a couple of Dorans and a null magic mantle.
Yeah, Eve completing that Magus enchantment, so he's going to be in a good place in terms of his early game damage output. Kuvei just happily farming under the tower. He's a level back now. And everyone just patrolling the Dragon Pit from Samsung on the bottom side. No real gank attempts yet from Eve. Focusing more on counter jungling and warding right now, but this one could be big. Six for Luna, misses the anchor toss.
Tucson had already passed smartly to bottom. Actually, the flash pulled miss from Ignar. Eve hasn't shown yet.
They have no idea that Eve is there. Now, they should suspect it. They definitely should suspect it. But
Eve has great lanes to gank for in every lane. That's why it's surprising that he's had no kill pressure whatsoever on the map. Now going to try around mid. This is what I expected from Frozen. Doesn't want to overextend. The flash pole, sorry, the headbutt pole comes in again. Luna gets low, but Roar himself takes by far the worst end of that trade.
Well, they walked right into a Foss and then a bomb right there, a rocket. So that's a pretty rough trade to take on both members of your duo lane. BF Sword is completed, and now just a little bit of a delay on the recall. Eve still looking for that angle. He wants to take down somebody. Frozen is such a juicy target.
Hasn't at all path to top lane. That's the surprise to me, Monte Cristo, is that although ganking a Vlad can be frustrating, you have the targeted CC. He has to pull the Twisted Advance if he wants to get through that CC. Then it should be the very easy spear to be able to get some big damage onto Vladimir, who, of course, hasn't itemized any resist, just gone for the pure AP and spell vamp of the World of the Ancients. But for now, Eve not concerned in ganking for top.
Yeah, they really would rather get some damage down on this bot turret, so Eve been looking for a counter gank in that bottom side and just allowing the duo to keep on pressing forward. Again, that mid game is going to be really strong in terms of sieging. And one thing about Eve as a jungler is he likes to show in lane a lot more than most other junglers here in Korea. He is he reminds me a bit of Svenskeren from SK, where he likes to be in lane, he likes to walk up and help his team auto turrets. You don't really see that often from junglers. It's not that it's not effective. In fact, it can be very effective. I like that kind of style personally. But it is something that Eve does, which means that having this early power spike with the Corki, because of how Eve plays, is potent for Siege.
You actually see the ultimate used by Norris going on top of Roar's only just come back into lane, has to use the heal and flash. Man, Roar cannot catch a break this game.
Yeah, two summoners used for none. That is huge, especially if Eve wants to gank right here. There's the headbutt pull. Nice flash from Eve, gets him out. Ignar looking just to bully his way through the enemy jungle as he sets down some wards. Now, Crown not going to be such an easy target.
Crown hasn't been able to get any solo kill pressure onto Frozen with just the Hex Drinker. He must have a lot of gold saved up at this point. Hasn't been to shop since getting the Hex Drinker about 6 minutes into the game. Victor just getting his way through laning phase leads to a potential possibility where you cannot take advantage of the favorable Zed Victor matchup while the laning phase is still going on. You know, we don't know how much longer the laning phase will go. No turrets down just yet. Fury, headbutt Pulv.
Again, there's the Valk over the top, but there's not really much follow-up. Fury has to flash. Flash from Tucson. Nice delay. And there's the Dragon's Rage into the kill. Roar will snag it at the end. Nice play from Tucson, actually.
But a mistake from Fury to be so far up the lane without Luna in lane, without any sort of defensive vision, just caught with his pants down and dies. Isn't able to finish the Trinity Force's next back like he would have wanted, just picking up the dagger.
And look at that timing, too, right as the dragon comes up. So this is an opportunity, if they want it, for Tucson and the rest of Incredible Miracle to take that objective, but it looks like they're being indecisive, and now Fury back up. Fury zipping back down into lane. And Eve gonna get the blue buff and hand it over to Crown, those shurikens. Oh, that was a bit of a missed opportunity there from IM. They definitely had a free dragon.
Yeah, crucially, they had lane pressure in top and bot as well. It seemed like a freebie in any other semblance of the word, but they don't choose to opt into it. Maybe they just weren't happy with their ward coverage, but it looks definitely sufficient. And a free dragon goes begging.
Yeah, very curious. So Armguard now for Frozen, and the makings of a Black Cleaver on the way for Crown as he buys himself a shiny new Cutlass. Fury's still waiting on that Trinity Force power spike. He could only get a dagger right after he died.
With a fairly defensive build being gone by the Zed, not actually that much solo kill pressure without any semblance of armor penetration against both the Seeker's Armguard and the Exhaust. So gonna navigate this mid lane fine. Doesn't mean that he won't be a source of damage in team fights, but Frozen isn't able to go the ideal build on Victor. You definitely want to itemize cooldown reduction as early as possible to give yourself the maximum amount of wave clear options. You're naturally going to be maxing the death ray first. So, look, he has to have built for lane, but at least he's navigated what has proved to be a very difficult laning phase. As Crown World has well known, he's lost this laning phase a couple of times in the reverse matchup.
And he's down in terms of CS as well. Crown has a healthy lead for 15 minutes in that regard. Apple continues to run amok up here. Now he's getting into that phase where Vladimir has all of that wave clear and can really start pushing in with the Tides of Blood. A bit of poke right there from Crown. But this is a big moment for Samsung. They need to get this bottom tower down. If this bottom tower goes down, Crown can head into the bottom side and the big, big siege, the 4-1 split starts. It is hanging by a thread. Samsung must kill this bottom turret soon.
And the timer is actually probably shorter than we expected, Monty, just because Apple hasn't even felt threatened enough to have to pick up any magic. There's no sign of a Spectre's Cowl. The spell vamp's been enough to keep him in lane, possibly because of all the early jungle pressure that he felt in the top lane. If he can just itemize into a Zhonya, very cleanly will deal with the split push from Zed. So things actually looking very good for IM, despite the fact that this was always going to be super tenuous in the mid game, depending on where the power actually shook out in the first 20 minutes.
Well, Tucson clearing some wards, and there is Samsung. They are starting to line up at this dragon, looking like they want to take it right after Fury picks up the T-Force. So they have the crab control right now. This looks like a good timing, actually. Luna has to flash out of that. Tucson finding an angle for a possible kick. Luna a little bit actually over-eager on that flash, I feel. He could have definitely survived that and popped his ult if he got ulted himself. So that would have been the end of the world. Kuve forced out. That's going to be a tower as I am. Causes problems in the dragon. Can they answer in the bottom side? Roar is there. Roar may have to use his ult if in this situation if he doesn't want to lose the turret.
So Kuve chose to back. He had mana. He could have just kept wave clearing as his turret slowly got chipped down. The spear lands. That will be the bottom turret you spoke about. They opted into giving up this turret for a potential TP play around the dragon. So you have to think that Samsung, with their new power spike, specifically the Catalyst and the Merc Treads on Kuve, and the Trinity Force completed are going to look for this second dragon that's actually been very extended. It's been live for at least 4 or 5 minutes now.
IM has been doing a good job, though, of making sure they don't get hit by a lot of this poke. Looks like the dragon's going to get activated as the wave hits the tier one in mid in favor of Samsung. So they have pressure as they juggle a little bit coming out of the pit. Now they're going onto it. IM knows what's going on. Going to peek in right here. Are we going to see an ult? There is a Lee Sin kick, and there is a steal from Tucson. And Crown not able to do much with that exhaust on him besides Deathmark Ignar for really nothing.
It's felt like Samsung didn't really actually go to contest that particular objective. They were happy to walk away. It seemed like Eve and Fury on different ways. You're going to see the engage. The insect kick comes through under Crown, and he's dead.
And that's a TP for Apple as well. Samsung may be looking to re-engage. Kuve's here. Everyone under the turret. Big Hemo plague onto several members of Samsung. But Fury still has that Trinity Force. He's still just firing those rockets, but it's just not enough damage. They get frozen, but lose Eve in the process. And they're going in again. Tucson a little bit too deep. Roar with the finish ult. However, more rockets. Apple trying to trade with his sustain, and they're going to get the turret, and not much more. Roar out of mana.
Still a 3-for-2 trade, and a dragon is massive for IM.
And a turret.
And a turret, as you mentioned. The steal. It was notable to me that Fury and Eve seem to be on opposing wavelengths. Fury actually went to DPS down, rocketed the dragon as it was around 1,500 health. Eve pounced away, so it was an easy secure for Tucson. Seems like shot calling wasn't really clear around the dragon.
Yeah, got to make sure who's going to be finishing that one. Tucson again, another nice insect kick, second of the night to get the kill on the Crown.
And they continued with the turret dive, so multiple members are going to die. Remember, Maokai's going to have a lot more impact at these early skirmishes than Vladimir. But Apple's so tanky, he's happy to tank the turret. In event they get Kuve super, super low. There's multiple re-engages from this point. We're just waiting for the second re-engage. Hit the kick onto Luna. Still fairly squishy. It was a one-for-one trade. Dragon for support, so that goes for Samsung. But in the end, they get the objective, and that's the crucial factor.
Yep. Still, though, still, IM, 1.5k gold lead. They haven't been able to do, I feel, enough with the advantages that they've been given. Of course, we do see the split push starting, and there's a needlessly large rod for Apple. Crown's going to get seen by that pink ward and back off. He's got the tools, I think, to take out this Vladimir now. Arm penetration, the flat one available. And here's that 4-1, or that they're actually doing 1-3-1 right now, but it's important that Corki and Nidalee are together.
The window's quite small, though, Monty. With the needless large rod and the amp time, we're only talking about 1,200 gold till the Zhonya's is complete.
Yep.
At minimum, need to take the turret before that's complete, but even then, split push is going to be super difficult for Crown. If they keep rotating around the Vladimir, yes, maybe they can make it happen, but
get the Maokai in that lane. He has the cowl.
That seems to be the right move. It's surprising that they've actually put Zed here. I guess it's just to break this outer turret in the top lane. They already have the turret in bottom, but getting standing gold would keep the gold lead much smaller from a Samsung's perspective.
Yeah, so Crown wants to push up. It's so hard to push into a Vladimir, though, at this level, because he's capable just of standing in front of the turret, tanking the minion damage himself, and then using the Tides of Blood with his spell vamp to just clear easily without taking any damage.
So the pressure then has to be in the mid lane. You mentioned Nidalee, Corki, Trinity Force procs, and the massive poke means that if a spear hits, you can walk up as Corki and get multiple Trinity Force procs down. The War of Attrition in top lane, you're basically just passing free farm over to a Vladimir, which is certainly not ideal for Samsung.
They have to move this Zed. This is not good right now. Let the Vladimir push up and then have the Maokai farm at tier two while Zed presses into the bottom side and threatens the tier two himself. It will be much more effective. Letting Frozen just go here. Eve just hasn't been there for the ganks this game. You gotta make a play. Victor can die at any time. He has no flash, and he's against a Maokai. They can easily kill him if Eve goes down to the bottom side.
These are just some of the strategic issues that have kind of plagued Samsung this season. I completely agree with you. There's just no point in passing farm after a Vladimir if you're Zed. It's all one of those scenarios where you're a Caitlyn and you're pushing wave into, say, a Kog'Maw or a Vayne to just equalize the CS. If you're trading CS with someone who has a late-game advantage over you,
you're losing.
You're losing, exactly.
You are losing.
10 CS, to Vladimir and Tensias to Zed are not created equally.
Okay. Alistair in the top side now as they move that wave a little bit beyond the tier one turret, but nobody's really been in the red jungle of Samsung in quite some time. Eve's farming right now, I'm a little bit skeptical of. He's got to start making some more plays like he did in the last one.
So to create the split push they want, what Samsung need to do is to have Eve and Luna patrol the red side jungle of LZIM. Put down defensive wards and allow Zed to overextend towards that inner turret. He definitely needs the ward coverage. We look down, there's a couple of warding totems. Maokai has one, Nidalee has one. Relieve some pressure from the Zed and ensure that he's split pushing away from the Vladimir, especially now that the Zhonya's is complete for Vlad.
Okay, well, Zhonya's also completed for Apple, so IM may have gotten out of the danger zone here, as it were, even as this dragon is about to spawn. Still going to be hard for them to take a dragon with the poke. As long as Samsung can land some of that, they should be okay. Maokai back in the top side right now. It's weird that they put the Maokai back in the top side for the TP and not because they weren't making any headway in the Zed versus Vladimir matchup. So now, turret's gonna go down. No one there to defend it at all. Free tower.
And in a game where they have the 1-3-1 advantage, they're losing turrets, Monty. That's a crucial factor. Only 2,500 gold lead, but it's bigger, as you mentioned, with the scalings that we're talking about. IM pick up the turret, just back away to a free dragon.
IM should never have been allowed to get into the river. How you play poke comps in that situation is you keep them at bay by controlling the choke points with your poke. And once that team gets into the river, you've already failed with Samsung's team composition because they're not bottled up to easily hit skill shots anymore.
Exactly. As you mentioned, a choke is a descriptive term. You're moving towards a term where you just cannot dodge the line skill shots of the likes of Nidalee, Corki. That's why you get punished when you're moving between those areas. In this case, Samsung, this is what happened against Anarchy. You remember in that game, Zed would split push, and then they back away to the closest objective, or Anarchy, whereas Samsung were kind of all at bay. If you have Zed split pushing in the bottom, Maokai would teleport in top. Zed pushes up a lane, they can back off to the dragon and pick up an easy objective because they have the lane pressure. With the setup they had, they just traded farm between a Zed and Vladimir. No pressure around the dragon, and as you mentioned, the dragon easily goes over to IM.
Now, IM, however, is getting the lanes they want, and finally, Papa, Samsung figured it out. So they saw Vladimir in the bottom side clearing out a wave. They immediately start that recall, and Crown goes top while the Maokai is sent to deal with him. But is it too late at this point? I think it might very well be. I mean, Crown isn't even pushing right now. He's going for Krugs. He needs to apply pressure, otherwise there is no point to playing Zed. These little Krug detours are not helpful.
And it's not creating enough pressure across the map. I mean, Raw and Frozen can both group in mid and wave clear. So Corki can't even get work done in that situation. Crown has definitely felt the wrath of two different Zeds in recent weeks, but his own Zed play and Samsung's play around that pick leaves a lot to be desired.
Well, it's just compare him. He just played against Mickey when they won a game because Mickey was killing inhibitor turrets with the Zed and the split push. And Crown seems not to know how to play this really at all. Or at least the team, whoever is shot calling, is not assigning him to the right lanes. And now he has to deal with Victor as well. Easy wave clear, no chance of an all-in while Victor has that Zhonya's under the turret. Very, very bad situation. IM has every advantage.
And Fury's on this Corki. We've seen this Corki highly prioritized in the first round of picks in multiple games, and they've lost all of them.
I don't get this Corki for Fury. He's such a strong individual player. Give him something that he can make the plays with. I love seeing Fury's Lucian. And it's not just the Corki. It's first pick Corki. What exactly is the priority on this Corki? Because it doesn't seem to work for Samsung at all.
You can maybe understand from a player like Prey is that actually that flash kick comes through. Luna is closer to his own team, though, and is able to back away. So this time, Tucson's insect play doesn't lead to anything.
Corki's great on teams like SK Telecom or the Koo Tigers, where when you hit an item power spike, they know how to take advantage of that. Samsung just looks clueless with the Corki in their hands. And now Crown going to get exhausted. He's going to have to flash. I mean, it's just Alistair and Lee Sin who are there, but that's enough with Frozen and Roar. walking into the top side to make him a bit nervous. Now, they have an angle onto the tower. They have the Nidalee and the Corki there. Maybe a nice trade, but the rest of IM, it's like they're going to get there in time.
They might have actually had to think about tanking that turret. Teleport's being used. We know that Luna doesn't have teleport, but the teleport's canceled.
Yeah, cancel on the port. Dredgeline does get Luna to safety. He was not interrupted right there. Kuve wants to go into Apple. Apple very, very vulnerable, and he's going to go down after using that Hemo play. Maybe eventually, Zonya's Hourglass for now. Tucson's going to get into the back lines. Chaos Storm on top of everyone, but Crown may be on cleanup duty. He's got the death mark. Samsung can and should have pursued that.
Crown, interestingly, with death mark available, did not go aggressive. He didn't have flash, but to not use the W shadow aggressively, the living shadow, and go for a pick at all.
All the ults were down for literally all of them for IM. There was such a small amount of threat for that Zed in that situation. Yeah, sure, the ult's been changed. You can't get out immediately anymore, but he had follow-up from his team there. Kuve was there. He was relatively healthy. I think that's a bit of a misplay. Samsung, it was a good pick. I mean, Apple was too far forward. He paid for it. But at the same time, you can take more if you're Samsung in that situation.
Well, Samsung literally lost Monty. Look at the wards that in that invade IM were able to put down. They have excellent ward control around the dragon, which spawns in a minute, where Samsung get a pick, get a free shot potentially, but can't really move up the vision or really push into an area that plays towards their win conditions.
Yeah, that's very true. And I mean, the best they did was shove a wave into the top lane turret. They couldn't take mid even, so. Oh, not good for Samsung. They can try and go for this dragon. They pretty much have to get it at this stage or see if they can trade two turrets worth. If they can get mid and top, it might be okay. But anything less than that, and this is not going to end well for them in terms of objectives.
I feel like the good Zed teams and the bad Zed teams, you can just look at the mini-map and know which one is. And that's not to do with where Zed is, where the vision is and how it moves with the Zed. As the Zed moves up a lane, so does the vision. All the vision around Zed is actually IM vision. He has no defensive vision. It's so much harder for him to overextend. In this case, okay, he sees five members, but that's because he's going to be giving up a dragon for this outer turret.
And Tucson goes in right there. He overextends it. It just explodes. The burst damage so high from Corki and Nidalee that is... bad idea. Tucson trying to make the play. Crown now gets the tower in the top side. They're going to go after two, holding IM there for as long as they can while still threatening that dragon. And Crown may get two towers and a dragon right now. Samsung really turning this around.
And Crown activates the Yomu, so actually has a lot of turret damage with that itemization. We didn't see a Brutalizer at all in the early game, but picks up a straight Yomu. Two turrets, and they should be able to back off the dragon as well. That's a massive strategic win.
Holy cow, two towers and a dragon now in a very strange turnaround as Tucson just throws himself to his own doom, basically. I'm not really sure. He was trying to get a fancy insect off. He's had some good ones, but you can't be that reckless. Otherwise, good teams will punish you.
An acute case of the Lee Sin-itis.
I think it's Lee Syndrome.
Jeez. Well. That's true.
Who would use Lee Sinitis when Lee Syndrome is there?
I'm just the worst.
We discussed that earlier.
And honestly, Lee Syndrome against a Nautilus who has so many ways to CC you.
All he needs is that one auto attack, and that 1 second against the burst of Samsung will be enough to take that victory. You know, one thing that we didn't talk about is that Crown is running Sweeper instead of a Warding Totem. He's not even helping himself in this split push. When we look at guys like Mickey, they run upgraded Warding Totems on Zed because it doesn't really matter if you clear the wards. It doesn't matter if they have wards. The only thing that matters is if you know there's another one or two people coming.
And the mindshare on assassins, and specifically split pushing assassins like Zed, has changed, as you mentioned. There was a time when Sweeper was very common. You'd sweep a brush, stand in it, and then look for the pick. It's just so much more regular to split push. It's much more advantageous both this game and with the kit that Zed has to pick up the Warding Totem to give yourself that defensive vision, like you say.
Yeah, the standing in a ward is, or standing in a brush is basically hoping that the enemy is going to make a mistake and
reactive.
Walk into it. It's reactive play. Whereas if you have the wards, you're constantly forcing the enemy to react to you or they lose towers. And that's just a more consistent and powerful way to play in almost all circumstances. Yeah, sometimes you get that miracle pick that leads to a Baron and a fast closeout win, but it's just not a high percentage play.
Tucson gets caught once again, chunked out to half health. Getting a bit cute with his positioning on Lee Sin. Still has the flash available, so in his head might be looking free. In fact, he actually used the kick, but just with no result.
Wow, Tucson really started this game strong, but as it continues, he's looking more and more desperate. And he, you know what? He doesn't have to be. Just let Ignar lead the charge with the engage with his combo and then follow up with a Chaos Storm and the Hemoplague. The damage from IM is huge. They have a damage amp in the Hemoplague and then so much from Victor.
Their itemization is also coming along. Corki actually flash pulse comes through from Ignar. Corki's very low, dies instantly. This looks like a good fight for IM.
Yeah, there's the culling as well. Luna not going to catch the tail end of it. There's a death mark on a Roar. Roar will die in the end, but will Crown pay for it as well? Exhaust already onto him. He's on a bit of a run right now. Can he go over the wall? Yes, he can. Ignite ticks down, and that was a bit of a waste of a Hemoplague there from Apple, actually. Kuve still in the bottom lane. Kuve not TPing into that engagement, instead prioritizing the turret. 2-for-1. Samsung stays in. Now, can they do the Baron?
It's a big risk. Look at the level disadvantage. Eve is level 16 to the level 14 of Tucson. Teleport will come in after a fresh shot. Baron's at 5,000 health. This is looking bad for IM.
It certainly is. Ignar very low. There's the Twisted Advance. Kuve gets kicked off, but that's not going to be quite enough, I think. It's like at least the Baron's going to be stopped. No more damage. Sphere misses. And they take away the blue buff at least. I am maybe sticking around a little bit too long here with low health bars. You know what? Oh, nice blue spear. Eve takes it. This could actually set up a counter Baron. They doing that blue buff. Oh my, Samsung's going to go for it.
Yeah, Lee Sin's coming back. We already mentioned the two-level advantage for Eve. I think Samsung got a chance. This Crown won't get there, though.
Well, Roar's not there either. Neither is Ignar. So they've got some time. The Apple taking a lot of poke damage right now. So is Eve taking damage from the Baron. Luna on the outside. Fury's going to get found by Roar. But they've got Vision in the brush. Apple knocked around by the Arcane Smash. Luna in the backlight. Crown coming through. Crown with a kill onto Roar. And this is going to be Samsung to clean up. They got the skirmish they wanted. And they got the poke. Double kill for Crown.
Their front line is so strong, Monty. Kuve on this Maokai was doing so much work tanking in the front line. Even though Eve had to disengage over the back of the Baron wall, the tank stood in the front. Fury was free DPSing, and they pick up the Baron.
I mean, right there, that blue buff contest from IM was really just sealed their fate. They weren't paying respects to the fact that Samsung was coming up with these timers. They were going to be walking over to the Baron with full HP bars. Instead, they got poked about a million times by Nidalee and Corki, and then this is the result.
But Luna in the front line with Kuve are so tanky, and they're able to free DPS. Roar gets into the back line, finally makes the dead pick work, justifies the pick as he gets the assassination on the only target left. There's double Zhonyas on this team, you'll remember. Able to just fight around and kill Apple from there. Good team fighting from both Crown and Samsung Galaxy.
And this is where the split push really shines, obviously. The problem when you run Zed is that he's just not as good in those 5v5 fights. And to get the Baron, you frequently have to win one. But when you get that Baron buff, holy cow, are you potent.
He's right up there with Lichbane, Twisted Fate. Maybe less safe, of course, without the ranged auto attack, but itemizing into attack speed and AD makes him a turret destroyer with the Baron buff minion wave, as you mentioned. He hasn't actually committed to going into the bottom lane just yet, maybe looking for a sly pick, but finally we'll start the split push in bottom.
Man, I can't believe I am. I mean, the Baron call itself wasn't that bad, but not respecting the death timers on the enemy and trying to fight so much around that blue buff was a big error, but Samsung played it cool. They kept poking and they got what they wanted in the end.
Eve's poke is hurting a lot, despite the fact that he spent 3,000 gold or so on the Banshee Veil. Shows you that the base values on that Nidalee are very high. There's no QSS being completed by Roar. How do you peel away this Zed? They've got one target for the death mark, and it's Roar. That seems to be enough.
I really don't think Roar needs that the F-Sword right now. I mean, the Bloodthirster sure will help, but that's going to be torn through by the poke. And then he's still a very nice target for the Zed in the end.
Tucson basically has to be on kick-away Zed duty. That's really the most he can do in a fight. Engage is certainly not something that he should be doing, despite the fact that he spent this whole game trying to put together a highlight reel of insect kicks. Needs to be defensive until, at minimum, the QSS is completed by Raw.
Crown recalling, actually, after pushing out that wave. Samsung taking their foot off the gas a little bit. They have to clear up the side wave in top, but this play, a little bit conservative for a team that just got a Baron. Now, they also picked up a massive gold lead as a result of all those kills.
Yeah, almost 10,000 gold. It's only about 8,000+. Banshee Veil is actually the pickup from Crown. You do not often see Zed's itemizing into quite as defensive an option as Banshee. In this situation, until the QSS is completed, doesn't affect his one-shot potential onto Raw just yet.
No, and usually, of course, you see a GA. Does give you that MR, but a little bit more cleanup potential if you do happen to go down in a fight. That is, the Veil, I'm not really getting it.
So what it shouts to me, though, Monty, only ways to deal with him for IM right now, getting on top of Raw, is displacement. It's either the headbutt from Alistair or it's the kick from Lee Sin. You're negating one of those with the spell shield. Maybe that's enough to get that reliable kill onto Raw. And if he's canceling out Raw each fight, Samsung should be winning.
Well, Roar is just a long way away from that QSS to help survive the death mark. Baron falling off of Samsung right now as they, a couple awkward double pink wards in a brush. They're trying to control this top side. They created a slow push in top, so they will have minion wave pressure eventually for a three lane push. Eve did go back and complete his Luden's Echo. That'll be nice. That'll be actually very helpful.
We saw Chaser itemizing the Luden's Echo early just for the massive poke damage and, of course, the little AoE that it provides when you hit a spear. Now, my question to you, do you still have Crown split pushing in the bottom lane when there's multiple people? In fact, now they've rotated Apple with both Zhonya's and TP to deal with it.
No. You push up in top lane right now where you have warded, and you do this. You move Crown to mid and take out the tier 2 with him. You don't try and push into an inhibitor turret right now. You just want to cut off the jungle and collapse on. If Tucson does something like that, if Crown was already there, he would be dead. So when you have the vision control on the top side, you want to move in that pattern. Otherwise, you have some more issues. And you can't punish people for walking through there for free.
You really can't split push an inhibitor tower. We just don't see that in the last 6 months or so of League of Legends. It's become so much harder to break the base on these split push duties. So, as you mentioned, we see.
Oh, they're going in. TP activated. Apple's going to get there. They're going to try and collapse onto a flank. Culling really not going to do a whole lot. They are so scared of the Zed in their backline as well. They should be. Great positioning from Samsung so far. And there is Kuve just locking up a choke point with that Arcane Smash. And now the poke continues to rain in. IM has to walk around, but Kuve's there. Fury going to flash forward. Tucson is just CC'd in the back line, and the Luden's procs continue to come in onto IM. Frozen finds himself just CC'd as Crown looks to clean up. He will have to back off crit onto him from Roar. Oh, they're gonna come back in on him. What is Roar doing?
I don't know.
That is really dangerous to try and push up the wave. He's gonna go onto Luna. Oh, actually takes the kill right there, as Kuve's going to come in with the TP. Crown maybe not wanting to fight this, but Eve has enough damage alongside Kuve that's going to be the ace. Roar, I think, got a little bit too big for his britches.
He saw the low health bars and thought about the triple kill 1v3. It wasn't possible. There's a lot of attack speed and AD on this team. Tucson's still 10 seconds away. Alston can buy a little bit of time, but realistically, this should be an inhibitor for Samsung Galaxy.
Yeah, it should be. I mean, the timing couldn't be better, Papa Smithy. Look at that. The Baron coming up in 30 seconds. Dragon coming up in a minute 20. You can just see the objectives lining up like dominoes for Samsung.
Eve does aggro the red. I think maybe shopping would be the smarter, but look at the damage. Just instantly deletes the red buff. My apologies on that one.
I didn't expect that to happen either.
Wow.
Well, he is level 18.
True.
So that helps. Tucson, only 16 still. He's had that 2-level disadvantage. And Eve, you know, we did criticize his lack of presence in the early game, but that entire time he was farming, he has 200 plus CS as a jungler.
That is a massive number. That's 70
a lot
above his opposite number. And Tucson ran the first 10, 15 minutes of this game, then just the over-aggression has been caught out multiple times and coincided with Samsung Galaxy really taking the ascendancy this game.
Yeah, this is going to be a tough objective to stop for IM. I mean, if it goes well, maybe they could take a Dragon right here and try and trade it for the Baron, but that's about the most they could hope for. Just the burst onto the back line, and it's difficult to itemize against because, yeah, Frozen has his Zhonya's, but he has no MR to deal with Eve, who is a huge assassination threat at this point.
Actually went back and finished the death cap. Now
oh
we're talking
my.
About a massive stack of AP. Don't have the exact number. I'm guessing over 600, given the fact that he has two needlessly large rod items. They are managing to hold off the pressure, though. Of course, the super minions pushing out in mid lane. What does Samsung want to do? Seems like they want to fight.
Well, Samsung just wants to poke, I think. Yep, that is a lot of damage for a jungler. And there we go. Apple is the first target. Has to pool to start off the fight. Luna going to get low, but he's not going to die to the Chaos Storm. But Kube finds himself punted into the back line. Kube still gets the kill onto Victor. And Apple starting to turn this one around, but everyone's so low. The poke just destroys Roar. And as well as Apple's doing in the sustain, the poke is too much. Double for Fury. And then Tucson on the run right there. Eve gonna.
Yakety sex going on in the back line. Eve's gonna try again. This is great.
He sees Eve with that ward, so there's no way he's gonna get hit.
But he's quite happy to just delay Lee Sin from getting back with the long death time. Gets it with the pounce. And Samsung Galaxy Monte Cristo, defying all, I believe, analysts' expectations with a comfortable 2-0.
All two analysts on this cast did not think this was going to happen tonight, but Samsung delivers. They bounce back with their poke, and that's going to be GG. Clean 2-0 for Samsung. Especially that first game was really well played by them.
I was impressed by Eve on Nidalee. Two games, two big wins. This game in particular, Teamfight Nidalee is such a
difficult
skill to pull off. Chaser did wonderful things in the series earlier this week, and now Eve smartly darting in our team fights, basically one-shotting Frozen, who had to Zhonya's, then just had 100 health after it. Very smart play from Samsung. Okay, in the early game, they suffered. Tucson looked really great, but then the Lee Syndrome, I've learned it now. I've consulted my DSM for this game. Lee Syndrome holding him down, and comfortable win for Samsung.
Yeah, well, it looked rough there for a while for Samsung. It looked like they may not have been able to take